Hey guys, it's Helvetica. This is going to be a full-length tutorial that includes everything I do to get to my final drag face. What I hopefully want to do is cover some tips and tricks to work with a more masculine face structure and talk about some stuff specific to bearded drag.
I'm going to take myself from this to this. Okay, so one thing that's super important is to make sure that you trim down your mustache. If you don't do this, you don't really have any space for a lip. I've seen a lot of bearded queens around where they do lips, but they pretty much end up with just kind of like hair covering the entire top. And that's a very masculine trait. Just trim right above the mouth. Most people have hair that grows pretty much right to the bottom of your lip. Drag requires you to overdry your lips at least a little bit. So what you basically need to do is shave just down a little bit. I swear this won't make your beard look super weird or anything. Most people would never notice it, but it adds a lot of space for you to play around with the lip. Just down like a quarter of an inch. There you go. And I'm only bleeding a little bit. Next is you wanna make sure that you have room for like a deep contour. A lot of people's beards go up really high. You need to take it down pretty far if you want to do a successful contour in bearded drag. Mine is already taken down a little bit, but I'm going to clean it up just a little, just to give me a little bit more space so I can have a swoop from like my ear to my mouth. Yeah, I'm bleeding. That should be about enough space for like a decent contour. So the next step for me is contacts. I'm super blind, so I need some form of contacts to do drag anyway, because without my glasses, I can't even see in front of me. I figure if I have to wear contacts anyway, they might as well be colored. Wow, irritating. So you can see because they're bigger than my actual pupils, they kind of add a little bit of like a cartoonish quality that makes you look a little bit more surreal. And when the makeup's done, it'll really add a lot. Before I get any makeup on, of course, I have to cover my eyebrows. But I know a lot of people really struggle with eyebrow covers. One thing that I find really helps me is if you take some rubbing alcohol and like dab it on a tissue and dig away all the natural oil under your brow. I'm using like 50%. I think that's like a okay amount to use. So the alcohol will help the glue stick better. I find when the natural oils are there, it's really easy for the hair to kind of separate from the glue and start to like push up and like pop out over the night. So the first thing I do to cover my brows with glue, an Elmer's glue stick, children's glue stick, like everybody uses, is to just slather kind of like all around it, like up and down and like all in there. And then really quickly, I kind of rub off the excess. You've got to do this right away because if the excess starts to dry at all, it starts to get all clumpy and shitty and there's no way to fix it. Then I take a little comb and I start brushing the hair up straight. And then I'll use the back of it to just smooth it out. And then once it's up, just another layer on top really quick. Brushing it up, making sure all the hairs lay flat up, assures that none of the hairs are overlapping any of the other hairs. Because when they overlap, that creates more bulk. And if you separate them, there's a better chance that it's gonna stay flat throughout the night. So I'm gonna do some powder. And then a few more layers of glue until they're as flat as I want. There's a lot of texture, you can kind of get the texture out of it doing more layers. And after every layer of glue, you should do another layer of powder. Invisible, right? Once they're covered and dry, I'm just gonna take a base of, this is one white in Krylon paint stick, and just, there you go. And I'm actually just gonna bring it down. I'm actually just gonna bring it down all over my eyes. And kind of use it as my base for my eye makeup, and then blend that in. I basically want to make like kind of like a mask across my eyes because I'm going to be doing my eyes first. I save my foundation until after I do my eyes, mostly because my eyes take the longest and they're kind of something you don't want to rush. So I'd rather do my eyes first, make sure they're good, and if I am in a rush at the end, I can kind of just do a shitty job on my contour and lips and stuff, because then people don't notice that as much as they notice like a fucked up wonky eye. I also have a lot of issues with fallout. And this gets me to the blank canvas stage, or as blank as my face gets before I start. And this is why I want to get into the idea of like masculine features and difficult to work with parts of the face. Most people who do makeup tutorials kind of already have a very feminine face. So it's easy for them to say, oh, you know, just do a little winged eyeliner, just do this, do that. Most men or people with male, I don't know, faces, I don't know, what's the appropriate non-gendered way to refer to that, have kind of like a lot of crevices and like just areas that are going to be problematic. My personal issues are my eyes are very deep set. And my brow is pretty prominent, like this bone here really sticks out a lot. So that kind of stops me from being able to do like a winged liner that just kind of like, you know, goes right off because it hits this bone and then looks all like, you know, wobbly, or, you know, if you try to paint it to not look wobbly and then from another angle it'll look crazy. So you've kind of got to find ways around that. And everybody's eyes are different. So what I'm going to do here is really only going to help you if your face is a lot like mine. So to start my eye makeup, the first thing I do is I'm gonna take some sugar pill. This is 2 a.m. It doesn't matter what you use, but I'm just gonna start to map out where my crease goes. So because I have such a prominent brow bone, I can't just put my crease where other people put their crease. You know, people wanna have like a big feminine crease. They wanna do kind of like that big thick liner and then have the crease, you know, up on top. For me, if I try to do that, my crease would go right on the most pronounced part of my brow bone. And that's not gonna be a good illusion. That's gonna look like, it's actually just gonna highlight how thick and like protruding my brow bone is. So because luckily I do have a little bit of eyelid already, my crease is pretty much aligned with my actual eyelid. It's a little bit higher. So you can see like, I'll go like in here, like up there, and kind of map out a shape. Now, I don't just go straight down into my socket because that's gonna just make my eyes look very downturned, and you usually don't want a downturned eye and drag, and some people do. The line I'm making here, and where I'm extending it to, is where my fake wing is gonna be. So I'm gonna try to blend out that crease a little bit before I really get into the eye. I'm gonna use this pink Dolly Pop by Sugar Pill, which is pretty pigmented, so I like to use a lot. And just kinda fade out the top of it. I kinda paint into this kinda little crevice in between my nose and my eyelid. Darken it up a bit. Something I and a lot of other people I think would do is just take a brush with no product on it and just kind of brush around. This blends it and gives you that kind of diffused look you need in areas like this. So I need to make sure this line is a lot darker, and it's gonna get a lot darker as I go on. But right now I'm just gonna reinforce it a little bit with, this is Poison Plum and Sugar Pill. A lot of times it looks kind of messy when I'm doing it, but that's because I'm going to blend it so much as we go on that I'm not super concerned about getting it like exactly perfect. You want to use a really soft touch when you do this. Don't like rub it in there. Just kind of glide along and it'll help disperse the makeup. Really, when you see people who are really blended, it's just because they do this for a really long time. Blending isn't hard, it's just time consuming. I'm gonna use some more of that Poison Plum to connect this line to my outer corner of my eye, and this is gonna create kind of where the wing is gonna be. You can kind of see the shape, it looks like a mess right now. Now, I'm going to take some of the pink Dolly Pop and put it under my eye. I'm going to diffuse it out. So this pencil, I'm going to use to further define the crease line. It's Night Moth by MAC. You'll see Miss Fame talking about it all the time. It's $20. I mean, it's good. It's like a really deep, like dark purple. I use those colors a lot, so it's worth it for me, but you don't need this pencil. I'm just going to smudge it out a little bit. So unlike most queens who do this first and then go in with like a slick black liner, I can't really do that because my eyes are just too deep set and like a little bit hooded on the outside that it's just gonna fuck up and be a mess. So I have to do this very strategically to make it look like a wing. So I'm just gonna take some black eyeshadow and start going in here and mapping out where the dark part of my lid should be and where the light part should be, because I have very tricky eyelids to work with, because I have a lot of eyelid space in the center but no eyelid space on the outside. So if I try to do like a, you know, a straight line across like everybody else does and do a nice wing, you're gonna see all the black in the center and you're not gonna see any of the black on the outside, which is like a horrible shape, right? It's kind of the opposite effect that you want. So I have to almost put no liner on the inside, just like a very thin, like just a thin stripe, and then a lot on the outside. And it takes a lot of like looking in a mirror and just kind of figuring out. So I'm starting with some black and like going up into my fake wing, because my wing has to kind of like go up over this like brow bone because it's prominent. I need my crease to be darker on the outside here and lighter on the inside. That also helps kind of separate my eyes because my eyes are a little bit too close together. I have this like big area of just like a flap of skin that I have to kind of get inside and just black it out completely so that when I like close my eyes or blink, you don't see what's actually going on. My trick essentially is that my wing is on my brow. It's on my brow bone. Like if you actually just extended from my natural lash line out, it would probably be like down here and it would be really downward pointing. So I'm just faking it completely. And just to make sure I keep everything really saturated, just take more of the Dolly Pop and like put it on top of the black. Because if you don't, a lot of times things get to be kind of gray or ashy. Okay, now I'm gonna take some of the black and extend it below the lash line. Just like, and I only bring it in like maybe a third of the way in, because any more, and like I was saying, my eyes are too close together and it just kind of makes it look heavy. I kind of want to make it look like someone is like grabbing my face and pulling it back. So I am going to use a glitter, and to make it stay, I'm going to use Prozade. You're probably not supposed to use Prozade on your eyes. I'm not super concerned. I'm just going to paint this on little brush, and then very quickly, because it dries fast, I'm gonna take this super pigmented Love Buzz and pack it in to the outer corner, and then take this Makeup Geek Light Year, which I also use as a shimmer a lot, and pack that into the inner corner, and then just kind of tap and blend them together. Blending glitters kind of sucks, but it can be done. See how messy I am? This is why I do my foundation last. So I've got the winged eyeliner done with eyeshadow, but it's not as dark as you want it to be. So I'm just gonna take any kind of like liquid liner and then go in and trace it all. Okay, so this is pretty much where I want my eyes to be before I start the rest of my face. It always just takes me a little while because of the layering and the weirdness of this shape. It's really easy for me to fuck it up and do it like too high and then it's on my brow and it just looks very bad, or too low and then it looks very like caveman. So this is like an okay place. I probably would have done it a little bit bigger if I could do it again. But it's okay for now, and if I need to add more pink around it to kind of open it up, yeah, just to make it bigger, I can do that. For foundation right now, I mean, I've used a lot of stuff, but for right now, I'm using an Anastasia Beverly Hills Contour Palette in Cream from Medium to Light. The colors are pretty good for me. I'm almost out of the main one that I need, but I'll probably go back to just pure, like, Krylon paint sticks. But this was fun to try. So I'm going to take, like, this big... Oh, I've always wanted to do that. This painterly kind of brush. I'm going to scoop out a whole bunch of foundation and start painting it on my face. I try to make my foundation, like, really heavy right under my eyes because I have these kind of indentations. And they always show up, especially under overhead light, but I try to minimize them as much as possible. Okay, so I like to do my contour in cream first and then in powder on top of that. So for cream, I'm just gonna draw a big streak on there. Then all around my forehead. I'm gonna take some of my one white, which is a little bit lighter than the base I used, and just put it in the spots where things should be brightest. And just keep tapping until it looks smooth. I save most of my nose contour for the powder stage, but sometimes it helps if I just do a little bit of it in certain areas in the cream stage. Mostly underneath and just like a little bit around the tip of my nose. For my contour, I usually try to go for a little bit of like a gaunt, sunken look. I just kind of think it looks more badass. It looks more kind of like villain. There's a bunch of different types of contours you can do. You know, some people try to make their cheek look really like apple and rounded. To me, that's a little bit too innocent. I don't really think that fits with like a Helvetica kind of face, so. And I'm naturally kind of angular. Like my cheekbones are pretty angular anyway. So I'm just kind of playing into that. So once it's all blended, this is where you take your powder and powder the whole thing, and it's going to make it look all even and as if you didn't do any contour at all. So sometimes I wonder why I bother to do this, but I'm convinced that in the end, it makes it feel like the contour is more, like has more depth or feels more real or something. But it probably doesn't. So this is where I go in and warm everything up and make sure my contour is like what I want it to be. With the, it's another Anastasia Beverly Hills contour palette in Medium to Light, but this is the powder one. So I like my contours to be pretty specific. So a lot of people would use a brush like about like this big and just go down, you know, down here or there. I will do that very briefly as like a starting point. But what I usually use is something about this size. That gives me a lot of control. So I'll start like carving out this kind of like hollowed cheek up by the, you know, sort of like by the top of my ear and kind of just like tap and spread it down and around until it's in the shape I want. I keep making sure that it's like darkest back here. And I'm going to use the little brush to kind of go in around my temples and hairline. Well, my drag hairline. Just a little bit around the mouth where the beard meets. Okay, so I'm pretty happy, well, sort of, with this contour. But now I need to work on the nose. The nose is difficult for me because my actual nose is crooked. It like leans this way. It like curves this way. So if I do a straight line up it, it actually just goes along a curve and looks just like crooked as hell. It looks way more crooked than it does with no contour. So the way I've kind of gotten around this is to mostly only contour the tip and then leave the rest kind of just, you know, just trying to make it invisible. Now my nose is pretty like sinister and kind of pointy, and it's already pretty narrow anyway. So, you know, it's not like I need a really severe nose contour. You can see like from profile, I have this like bump. It's very Disney villain. It's very like Maleficent, it's the mother, the stepmother from Cinderella. Lady Tremaine. There you go. So I'm just gonna start going in with some small brushes to kind of taper and make this tip of my nose a lot skinnier. First step is to just help raise the tip. And this is something everybody should be doing. Whether your nose kind of points down or not, you can raise where the point of it is. So it's more feminine and kind of more fierce to have like a tip that's kind of like here, right? So I'm just kind of like darkening and putting a fake shadow underneath it. So it creates the illusion that my nose is pointing up more than it is. Then I'm taking this like little fluffy brush and softly painting in shadows around the tip of my nose. A lot of queens kind of do really pronounced nose contours these days. I don't love that look. I think it kind of even brings a lot of attention to the nose. So I try to keep mine pretty diffused. Plus it's already so pointy, you know, like I don't really need to make it look pointy. It is pointy. I can't contour past this point because this is where the big, like, where my nose just goes off the rails into this like weird bump. If I contour straight up here, it's gonna make this bump super apparent. I'm also just gonna contour like the insides of my like fake eyelid kind of, well, it's kind of like my real eyelid, and like lead it into the nose. It just helps everything look connected. I'm getting a little bit carried away, so I'm just gonna add a little bit more definition to the tip. And that's like kind of my Helvetica shape where it kind of goes like that. So I actually find when people want to make their noses look smaller, if your nose is already kind of skinny, what works better than kind of this subtractive method of contouring is more of like an additive method of using some kind of like lighter contour. Like I'm going to take some Clown White Light and I'm just going to take like the smallest bit and like dab the tip of my nose and draw a line just up it a little bit, but not the whole way. Because if I do it the whole way, you're gonna see the nose bump. So it kind of looks like a shimmer. Like it's just so pointy that it has this sparkle on the tip of it, right? I mean, everybody does this, but it works. And then what I usually do is I have this like shimmer color. And I actually used it for the inside of my eyes. I'm just gonna lay that on top to really make it shiny. And while we're at it, I might as well take just a little bit and do the shimmer thing that everyone does on the highest point of your cheek. This isn't a real shimmer, it's like a glittery eyeshadow, but I like it more than any of the shimmers I have. Last step in my contour is to take, I'm actually going to use Dolly Pop again. So I'm just going to take a little bit of this and just kind of tap around the contours to add in some color. Plus, you know, I'm an 80s queen. So I kind of love that like really prominent blush kind of look. And I'll add a lot more of it in towards the ear and then around the forehead. I know my forehead contour looks really harsh, but my wig actually lays kind of like right along here. So it's, it's not like my wig is back up here with my crazy receding hairline. I'm feeling kind of like the center of my face isn't popping quite enough. So I have some white powder that I'm gonna go and add in. I'm gonna go right under the eye and like make that kind of triangular shape on the face. And then I'm just gonna brush it away. But I packed it in hard enough that some of the white should stay. So that's the contour. The contour is finished. At this point, this is my favorite part. I get to go in and do the brows. This is probably what a lot of people are waiting for, right? So when it comes to brows, I always match my brows and beard to my wig. I just think it makes it look like it's all kind of growing out of your head a little bit more. I'm not really, like, I know a lot of people will do mismatched, like, brows and hair, or like, mismatched, like, bearded queens will do a mismatched hair and beard, but it's never worked for me. I always feel like when I do it, I always feel like it distracts or, like, detracts from the overall look. So I know I'm gonna wear, like, a kind of like a lavendery purple wig. So I want my brows to look like that. So I'm gonna go in first with the same color I used on my eyes earlier, which is 2 AM by Sugar Pill. And I'm gonna start mapping in where my brow should go. What's really important for me is the shape of my brow. I've really kind of gotten it down to a science. My brow helps a lot to fix the masculine features in my face, particularly the brow bone. What a lot of people do when they're drawing their eyebrows, they've blocked out their brows, so they think that they have this great opportunity to draw their brows like higher. It's a bad idea to start your brow almost always. Not for every look, but if you want to look natural in any way, you should always start your brow, your fake brow, where your real brow starts. This is why a lot of queens will shave off half of their brows, because they're still using the front part to kind of, look like there's some real hair there. My brows actually are too high for how I want them to look in drag, so I draw my fake brows a little bit lower, and I actually try to kind of merge them into this contour here, into the like the inner eyelid and the nose. Typically start about here. Like right there. So starting here helps create this illusion that my brow bone is a lot less prominent than it is. It also helps make, like I don't have a giant eyelid. So it helps it all look like part of one shape. And I don't arch it up until it's kind of like further out. When the arch is further out, it'll make your eyes look further apart. If you already have eyes that are far apart and you're doing that, it's probably gonna make your eyes look really far apart, unless that's what you want. So I'm tilting it up and cutting through my natural brow at this point. My natural brow being right here, I'm sure you can see it. And I start to arch up a lot. And this gives me that super like evil, sinister look that I love. So I'm gonna make the arch like about here. Once I decide where the brow peaks, it doesn't come back down. I just start to draw lines straight across. A lot of times I'll actually use my forehead lines as a way to gauge symmetry. If you don't have forehead lines, fuck you. You can see how bitchy it starts to look just like immediately. So for definition, I'm gonna start going in with this Night Moth color again. Really, I think any dark shadow would even do with like a thinner brush, but I have this and it's super high quality, so I'm gonna use it. The idea of the brow is that it should be the darkest toward like at the tail and kind of fade as it goes forward. I don't fade it as much as a lot of queens do here. There's kind of that like ombre brow trend that like I don't really buy it completely, but it definitely helps, especially for me with my eyes being too close together, to have the darkest on the outside and the lightest on the inside. One important thing about brows is that they should always kind of end like parallel to the end of your eyeliner. So if you can all just hold a brush like this, they should meet up that way. If one of them is like gone way over, you can kind of get away, like it's okay if the brow goes over, but if your eyeliner is at a different like angle and it's going to converge at a different point, then your brow, things kind of look shitty. There's just kind of like a like an angular rule, like it kind of helps things look like, you know? I don't know how to describe it. I just know it looks better. There was a lot of times in like season 7 where Ginger Minj would have the tip of her brow and the tip of her liner touching, so it created this kind of triangle shape. Yeah, I can't handle that. So the last step for the brow is I take some of this like clown white light and go underneath the tail. This is kind of like fake highlighting your brow bone. So you can use this to clean up that tail. And kind of using that converging parallel rule or whatever it is, I kind of do the white to this imaginary line and then blend it into the skin. And then I just set that with some white powder. So once again, I'm gonna go in to my Dolly Pop. I'm gonna go in and I'm just gonna add some color just like around the bottom and sides, kind of extend it out this way. So this is the part that kind of freaks me out, but because my eyes are kind of naturally tilted down and I'm trying so hard to tilt them up, one thing that really helps a lot is like an inner corner that tilts, that points down. But because my eye isn't as big as some other drag queens do it, I have to make sure that my inner corner is pretty subtle. So I have to do this tiny little kind of downstroke past the actual eye. So I'm just gonna be really still and really quiet and see if I get it. Like that. It's pretty subtle. Probably do it a little bit bigger, actually. There we go. And the other one. The very last thing I like to do with my eyes is I'm going to take some of this 2 a.m. color again, and I'm just going to draw along my bottom lid this shape, which is just like a little line, and there's a little gap, and I'm going to put white in this little gap. I'm going to go in with the clown white light and just a little line. There, if you can even see it. And that's it, except for my lashes, which I put on last because they're so uncomfortable, and any second that I can delay putting on lashes, I will. All right, so we're at the part that everybody has asked me about every day of my life for the past 3 or 4 years, and that's how do you color your beard? How do you color your beard, Helvetica? How do you color your beard? How do you color your beard? Oh, you do drag with the beard? How do you color the beard? So this is how you color the beard. It's the easiest thing ever, and there's already a tutorial up that I link to people, and it still just never seems to be enough. I use these little Ben Nye cream color things. I think they're like, you can get them for probably like $4 a little pot, maybe on sale. I think certain websites will charge up to like $7, but it's just like a little pot of color. They're like cream. Then you can use them for skin too. You can use it as like a skin contour. A lot of people use them for like a lid color to like as a base before putting on the color similar to this. So basically, I have a whole bunch of these. I have them in like every single color. I pick the one that matches my wig the closest. If one doesn't, I might have to mix like two colors together. The wig I'm wearing today is pretty much this color exactly, like a lavender. Well, mauve is the official title of this product. I put my finger in it and I rub it through my beard like that. This is all I do. Now, certain colors are easier than others. A darker color is easier. A lighter color takes a while for it to really get good coverage. Yellow's a bitch, but you know, like a blue is really easy. Like if it's a darker blue. Red is really easy. Green, like pretty much saturated colors are easy. This one's a bit difficult because it's kind of like a lighter, less saturated purple. Now it is pretty goopy, so it kind of sucks to have in. It sucks to wash out, and as much as you powder it, it's never really gonna set, so you kind of have to avoid touching anyone all night, especially if people try to do that drag queen like double kiss thing, because I've ruined people's faces. I just don't tell them, they figure out later. I feel like having color in the beard makes it look like you did something. without it, like, I feel there's so many bearded drag queens out there with, like, you know, they'll wear, like, a bright red wig or a bright pink wig or, like, a, you know, big turquoise wig, and their beard is just, like, brown. And to me, that is, it just doesn't go, it doesn't fit, and I think it's ruining the illusion for a lot of people. And I think it's part of the reason why there are not a lot of, like, really popular bearded drag queens. So once I've got it all rubbed through, I take a comb, and I just start combing through, kind of spreading out the product. So once it's all brushed through, you do have to powder it. So I kind of find the closest eyeshadow I have. I have this kind of like shimmery lavender one. So I'm gonna take some of that and just start pressing it in. This can also help enhance the color a little bit. I like to make sure that the line right here is really tight and clean, but not so straight that it looks like you have a fake beard. So just like a little, like straight across, but and even, but like a little bit diffused. Because beards kind of naturally have like a little bit of a color variation in them, I like to go in with just like something a little bit lighter, a little bit darker, and just kind of add some spots that are, just make it look a little bit more natural and not just like one blanket color. This is like a dark, this is a poison plum. And there we go, now my beard is like lavender-ish. I didn't do like all the way in here, and I didn't touch underneath because, well, this is a tutorial, I'm not even going out. But a lot of times it just doesn't matter, no one sees it, and it's such a bitch to wash out. My wigs are usually really big and full, so they kind of cover that anyway. Okay, now we're on the home stretch. It's time for the lips. So lips with a beard, it's difficult to make the decision what color they should be. What I see a lot of bearded queens have an issue with is they do kind of like a really dark beard, and then they also do a dark lip. And then it all just kind of turns into one big like mess of like dark color on the bottom of your face, and you can't really distinguish where one starts and the other ends. So lip and beard contrast is very important. But also, you know, you want your lip color to go with the entire look. So for me, my options right now is to do kind of like a bright pink, similar to this. Or because my beard is not super dark, I could do kind of like a darker, kind of like ombre, like purple. So I think I'm actually gonna do like a dark outline and then kind of like a purplish pink on the inside and just kind of like blend it. I should probably be doing that instead of talking about doing it. So I'm gonna use my Night Moth lip pencil again. This is where you're really gonna see the benefit from trimming the top of your lip, aka bottom of your mustache. Because I have a little bit of space here for me to overline. I like kind of like a prominent Cupid's bow. And I just kind of start where mine actually is and then go up a little bit further. I kind of feel like a lot of people overdo their, okay, I definitely feel like a lot of people overdo their overdrawn lips. Luckily, you have a beard, it kind of stops you from going crazy, but yeah, some people will do like really flat color lips that are like way out here, and you can just clock their actual lips like right away. It's so obvious where they are. It ends up just looking like a mess. You don't know where to focus. So that's why it's so important for you to do this kind of like dark outline around and then blend it at the center, because it helps hide the natural border of the lip. I'm gonna use my Flash palette, which is like $1 million. So if you don't do drag all the time, I wouldn't get it. I'm just gonna grab some of the pink. So it's not blended at all right now, but I'm actually gonna use eyeshadows to make this go together. The inside corners should be dark, and it helps just kind of make it look like your lips are popping out a little bit more. Then there's the last thing. I have just a little bit of like sparkle Makeup Forever Lab Shine. It's just like a little bit of a gloss. So I'm just gonna dab a little bit in the center and rub it around. And that just makes it look like my lips are wet, like lips are supposed to be. So I think we're about ready for lashes. So I'm gonna use this fucking old nasty pair that I've been wearing for, because I do drag once a month, a year, I don't know. My lashes are two pairs of 301s and then one pair of 301s cut in half and attached to the end. And then I cut them specifically so that they're shorter on the inside and longer on the outside. And that kind of gives me that cat eye that I like. And the shorter on the inside helps expose the little bit of eyelid I have in here. And the longer on the outside helps hide the skin I have out here. Ugh. Fucking giant glob just came out. They say you should wait like 15 seconds before it's ready to put on. Something that every single queen will tell you is to never put your lashes actually on the lash line. You begin on the lash line, but then you have to lay, like, just kind of lay it like a little bit up so I can actually fit my finger like in between. So that'll just tilt your entire eye up. So you can see the way I've designed this is for it to expose the best part of my eye and hide the worst part. Ideally, what you do right now is you take some mascara and brush it up so that your natural lash blends into your fake lash. I don't have any for some reason right now, so I'm just gonna pretend that it looks okay. Personally, I don't really like to wear bottom lashes. I know it's a huge trend right now, so like in most other people's tutorials, they'd be piecing in the little lashes and adding little gems. I don't really think Helvetica is a piecey bottom lash and gem girl. Now, one last thing I like to do to my face, and a lot of people do this, but I don't know why it makes it look better, but I like to add like a little beauty mark. So let's go in with my Sailor Moon. There we go. Okay, let's see what I can throw on really quick. It's okay. Fuck, I forgot to say comment.